Good evening and welcome to the January installment of VIMS's 2021 After Hours Lecture Series. Thank you for joining us tonight. My name is Candace Swenson and I am the Outreach and Events Coordinator at the Virginia Institute of Marine Science, and I will be your host this evening. Tonight's program is made possible by First Advantage Federal Credit Union, Phillips Energy Inc., and as all of our many supporters of the VIMS Impact Fund. Our theme for the After Hours series this year is Innovation at VIMS, and tonight's program is a perfect way to kick off the series. Lisa Kellogg and Dr. Eric Hilton will be talking about their novel app, RecFish. This work has been made possible by the VIMS Dean and Directors Innovation Fund. The Innovation Fund was established in 2018 by the Joan and Morgan Massey Foundation and the Nunnally Charitable Trust with the goal of supporting VIMS researchers in the development of innovative ideas that solve real-world problems and have the potential for ecological and economic impact. Lisa Kellogg was one of two researchers at VIMS to receive Innovation Fund's inaugural award in 2019, and she received it again in 2020 for further app development. And I'll now introduce Lisa and Eric. Lisa Kellogg is a research scientist at VIMS whose work has focused primarily on oyster reefs and oyster aquaculture. The concept for RecFish grew out of her desire to better understand the value of oyster reef habitats to finfish in Chesapeake Bay, recognition that oyster reefs are rarely sampled as part of traditional fishery survey efforts, and interest in how data collected from the recreational anglers might be used to supplement existing fisheries data. Lisa has been fascinated by animals and how they interact with each other and their environment for as long as she can remember. Summer trips to the beach in Northeast Florida instilled a love for all things aquatic. Lisa is the founding director of RecFish and oversees all aspects of the project. When she isn't busy thinking about RecFish or oysters, Lisa enjoys taking her son on walks in the woods, family trips to the beach, gardening, and reading. Dr. Eric Hilton maintains an active, vibrant research program that is at the forefront of biology of fishes. He uses a transdisciplinary approach to investigate the diversity and evolution of fishes worldwide. He is also involved with a wide array of projects on local fishes, including the biology of anadromous fishes in the Chesapeake Bay. This part of his research program supports the management of species, and Dr. Hilton serves on technical committees for the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission. He also leads extensive field experiences for students. Dr. Hilton received an undergraduate degree in wildlife ecology and a PhD in evolutionary biology from University of Massachusetts Amherst and conducted postdoctoral research at the Field Museum in Chicago and the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. And now I will let them take it over. Lisa and Eric.
So I'm very excited to tell you today about this new project. And to be honest, it's a whole new branch of research activity for me, because as Candace mentioned, I have traditionally been a benthic ecologist studying oyster reefs, but for this project we've paired up with Eric because he knows a lot more about fish than I do, and we're also doing this project in collaboration with Rob Portell, who is one of the VIMS Innovation Fund work group members, who's been spectacularly helpful in getting this project off the ground. We also work with Jennifer Dreyer and Sarah Muffelman at VIMS, and we're collaborating with Dharmesh Trivedi and Harshil Shah and their staff at DX Factor, who's providing the website development and app development and machine learning model side of things, because those are not things that I know very much about, but I'm learning. So I have traditionally studied, as I said, oysters and oyster reefs, and mostly looked at the ecosystem services provided by oyster reefs in terms of water quality and habitat for other organisms. But one of my more recent projects started looking at oyster reefs as a foraging ground for finfish. And we were looking at the diet of finfish that were utilizing oyster reefs. And when we went to compare the data that we had, that we had recently collected with data for diet of some species for all of Chesapeake Bay, which is collected by VIMS and freely available, we found some mismatches between what we were seeing on oyster reefs and what we were seeing in the broader data set, which really made me start looking in detail at fisheries independent survey data and how those surveys are conducted and why we might be seeing something different on oyster reefs than what we see in these broader fisheries independent survey data sets. And so a fisheries independent survey data is the gold standard of fisheries survey data. It's the highest quality data, but it's expensive to collect. And so it's pretty limited in spatial and temporal scale. The CHESMAP survey at VIMS is one of the most rigorous and extensive fisheries surveys in the US. And the samples are collected using a trawl towed by boat. And the trick with that is that it generally requires a depth of greater than or equal to about 3 meters. And they collect samples every other month from March to November. And that's much more extensive than many other fisheries surveys. And so in the map on the left, what you can see is the area that's actually covered by the CHESMAP survey is outlined in red on that map. And I'm going to show you a close-up of that in the next slide. And so this is a section of that. And again, the red hashed area is actually area that is part of the CHESMAP survey area. And then what I'm showing you also on the map is where the seagrasses are in this area in green. And then in the black patches are actually oyster reefs. And so what you see is that there is a lot of area of seagrass and oyster reef that's in these shallow areas and up in the tributaries that don't really get sampled by a trawl survey like the CHESMAP survey. And I started thinking about, you know, what are we missing by not sampling these areas? There's a big push towards fisheries-based, ecosystem-based fisheries management, but structured habitats are actually really hard to sample because you can't pull a bottom trawl. If you pull a bottom trawl through a seagrass bed, you're going to damage the seagrass bed. If you try to pull it through an oyster reef, you're going to damage your trawl. The way we've tried sampling is using gill nets, but it's very expensive and time consuming and labor intensive. Some places on coral reefs, it's feasible to use video and do video surveys of fish in coral reef habitats. But in Chesapeake Bay, the visibility just isn't that good. And so trying to use video there is probably not going to be that useful because you can't sample a very large area just due to the visibility. So as I was thinking about all of these problems and how we might get a better sampling of these structured habitats, out came the VIMS Dean and Director's Innovation Call for Concept Papers. And as Candace said, it was intended to provide support for research and education activities that foster innovation. And so it gave us an opportunity to really think outside the box. And so we started thinking about what we could possibly do in collaboration with recreational anglers, because recreational anglers target structured habitats. That's why we have artificial reef programs like the artificial reefs that are shown in the map on the right. It's so well known and so frequent that fishermen and anglers really like to target these structured habitats, that the fish finders, some of the newer ones are now coming out with ways to create your own maps of a grass bed so that you can go back and fish the edges of that grass bed. And so we started really thinking about what we could do with recreational anglers because there are so many of them. So NOAA data show that there were about 202 million fishing trips a year, about 8.6 million anglers just in saltwater fishing. And so about over half of that is on the Atlantic coast, and over half of the fish that are actually caught in estuaries out of the saltwater fishing trips. If you include freshwater angling, some estimates are that 17% of the American population goes fishing at least once a year. So there's this huge untapped potential of recreational anglers who actually catch fish, they weigh fish, they measure fish. And what we were interested in is trying to figure out how we might be able to turn those recreational anglers into community scientists, how we might have them collect data. And so in thinking about that, I had in mind the success that the Cornell Lab of Ornithology has had with their eBird app and their Merlin Bird ID app. And so about 15, a little more than that, years ago, they started developing these apps, particularly for birders, that allowed them to collect data on the birds that they saw. And so the way that they enticed people to use it is they provided valuable services to people that were already interested in their target species. So they now have ways to help them find birding hotspots. There, you have an interactive field guide on your phone. You don't have to carry a hard copy field guide with you anymore. You have everything you need to ID a bird right on your cell phone. Birders are infamous for keeping life lists, and that's kind of a long list to manage and keep track of, and so they provide opportunity to do that. And they also provide an extensive library of photos and sound recordings, and they've been so successful in enticing birders to use that app that annually they now have 500,000 birders submitting information on over 100 million bird sightings per year. And this animation on the right, I'll show you what you can do just in terms of distribution maps if you have that kind of data. So this is just one of their maps of Baltimore Orioles migrating from Mexico up through the US. And so if you just watch that animation, you'll see, and those are actual recorded bird sightings. And those are the birds moving in and out of the US. And I was just fascinated by this and thinking about what could we do with fish moving in and out of Chesapeake Bay. They also have a huge amount of additional data. They can do status and trends for species throughout the US to show where they're increasing or decreasing. They've produced over 300 scientific publications to date because they make this data freely available to anyone who wants to use it. And so we started thinking about how we could apply that to recreational anglers, but we recognized that there's some pretty big differences between recreational anglers and birders. And some of those are going to be advantages, and some of those might be disadvantages or things we need to work around. So anglers get much closer to their catch than birders do. They have to measure them to make sure that they're legal. Sometimes they weigh them. But anglers might be a little hesitant to share the exact location of their catch. So we're thinking about ways that we can share by a larger region than just your favorite fishing spot. And then few anglers keep track of what they catch, but many birders keep a life list. So there's not as much of a tradition of data collection by hand for recreational anglers as there necessarily is for birders. So keeping all those things in mind, we decided to go ahead and go with this concept of trying to build on the eBird model, that style of app where we are providing services for recreational anglers and provide services similar to that using an app for recreational anglers. And we first proposed this with the first innovation fund. We just wanted to explore whether this was a viable idea. And we did enough research that we decided that it was. We then leveraged that funding into an award from the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. They have an electronic monitoring and reporting grant program that focuses primarily on commercial fisheries. But they were willing to give us funding to go ahead and build out a wireframe for the app, which is essentially the app design. And then more recently, we were given a second Innovation Fund award to develop a proof of concept for the app and to develop a website. And I'll talk about the website more at the end because we need lots and lots of photos for what we're doing. And I'll explain that in a moment. And then most recently, we've got a second NFWF award, which is actually going to let us truly develop and build out this app. So we're extremely excited about that. So this is the concept that we have for the app right now. This is what we think of as our core functions. So what you will be able to do with the app is essentially take your phone, point it at a fish, and automatically your phone will ID that fish. In this case, it's a striped bass. That information will pop up. It will also automatically measure the fish with some degree. I mean, it will likely have a little bit of error in the measurement, but we think that's going to be pretty small. And so this means that you can actually measure your fish automatically and not have to always have a measuring board on your boat to measure them. We're also going to provide an estimated weight of the fish based on the length. And then really importantly, as a service to the anglers, we're going to provide a very easy way to instantly know whether your catch is legal or not. So that's what's shown in the upper left-hand corner. We're hoping to make it as simple as if you need to throw that fish back in, an X is going to pop up beside it on your phone. If you can keep the fish, you get a check mark. If there's something like a bag limit that you need to know about, then there'll be an option to get the additional information that you need to know whether or not you can keep that fish. We're also going to allow you to snap a photo of the fish with all of this information captured on the photo. And we're going to have a logbook function that allows you to capture all the data. So that'll be date, time, location, to the resolution that you choose to make it, and the ID of the fish and length. And you will have the option to, if you choose, upload those data and share them with fishery scientists and with management. Where we are now with the app development is that we're working on the model training. So this is the automated ID of the fish. And to train the model requires about 5,000 photos per species. So what we've done is we've developed a website. We expect that website to go into testing with the public in about a week. And what we want people to do is go back and look through their photos, and anything that has a fish in it, upload your fish photos to us so that we can use them as part of the model training. We've already have enough photos to develop the machine learning models for the first 10 species. And we're really pleased because those machine learning models are already at a greater than 90% accuracy in identifying the fish. So we really feel good that we're going to be able to do this. And one other thing to note is that we're focusing on Chesapeake Bay first, but we hope to expand to other regions. And Eric is going to take over the talk now and tell you more about why we started with Chesapeake Bay. Eric?
The Chesapeake Bay is a very interesting and very important part of the world. And if you're a fish in particular, here we are, the circle points us where we are in the Chesapeake Bay, not just the bay itself, but the watershed. The bay, it's the largest estuary on the East Coast, and it has an incredible amount of water coming in from all directions, from the east, from the Atlantic Ocean, and from the west, the fresh waters. It's a huge area. Up to into New York, waters from southern New York, Pennsylvania, most of Virginia, all drain into the Chesapeake Bay. It's a huge watershed. And again, it's a very dynamic watershed, including both freshwater and marine influences, as well as just physically, the temperature swings from going from 0 degrees to over 30 degrees Celsius. It's just an amazing area to be a fish. Here we are kind of in the middle. So we're in the middle between this blue circle above in the North Atlantic, this really cold water, and to the south, very tropical or warm water environment. And where these two meet, we pick up fish from both sides of that environmental barrier. This quote from the ocean dumping quandary really encapsulates us. South of Cape Hatteras is the domain of the tropics. North of Cape Cod is the cold Atlantic. The middle Atlantic, which we are here in solidly in the Chesapeake Bay region, has the marine flora and fauna, which is a compromise between these two regimes, called the Virginian Biogeographic Province. Many of the species, particularly the fishes, move between those to the north cold environments and the south, the tropical environments. And thus, it brings in this really rich fisheries environment. That migration is a really important aspect of the dynamic nature of the Chesapeake Bay fish fauna. And it's one of the reasons that it's such an interesting place to be an angler, to be a fisheries biologist. Many of the fishes, there's about 300 or so species of fishes that have been recorded from the Chesapeake Bay, but only about 30 of those are considered year-round residents. So this is a really unusual circumstance for many parts of the world. You have more residential than migratory species. That's not the case here. And that represents a challenge to fisheries biologists, but it also represents the impact that the Chesapeake Bay itself has on the fish fauna. Also, because it's in between these two extremes, the cold North Atlantic and the tropical mid-Atlantic, it's a lot of species are either south of here or north of here. But being on the edges of those ranges for fishes often indicates that populations are smaller or patchier. They're more susceptible to environmental changes or degradation. And it's important to know where fishes are, and that will be one of the kind of outcomes of this type of project, is getting a better understanding of distributions of fishes across the year, across different time periods. Okay, so that is a continuum from the north to the south, but the Chesapeake Bay is also the midpoint of a freshwater to marine continuum. So fishes, again, move both north to south during the season, during the year, but also in and out of the freshwaters of the tributaries to the Chesapeake Bay. And really, the aquatic environments of the Chesapeake Bay provide a continuum from the mountain streams of the Appalachians, which is a recognized biodiversity hotspot itself, all the way down into Norfolk Canyon. Just 70 miles off the coast here are over 6,000 feet of water. This is an incredible continuum of aquatic environments that promotes a really interesting freshwater, marine, and estuarine fish fauna. Remarkably, the freshwater fishes of Virginia are remarkable for their beauty, for their forms. These are some of the darters that are found up in the headwaters of the James River, of the New River in the western part of Virginia. So we have this remarkable freshwater fish fauna in the state of Virginia. We also have remarkable deep sea fish faunas off of the coast here. Here in the Norfolk Canyon, we get many of these bizarre, otherworldly type fishes that folks sometimes do encounter, particularly things like the fangtooth is caught over the Norfolk Canyon. So there's a huge amount of fish diversity out there. Reason we're focusing on the Chesapeake Bay is it's a nice, dynamic, important group of fish species. There's 270 species of fishes that are considered resident Chesapeake Bay species. Going from the common kind of thought of fishes, such as the spot and croakers and flounder, to more unthought of species, such as the stargazer and sea robins. Above that 270 species, there's about 51 rare species or visitors to the bay. Seasonal tropical fish that species that get up into the southern Chesapeake Bay, as well as some introduced species. And RecFish will enable us to keep track of some of these introductions, both natural and intentional. For over 400 years, the Chesapeake Bay has been exploited, has been used for fisheries, has been impacted by folks putting new species into the environment. So there's been over 400 years of potential for introductions of species. Only about since about 1860s has there ever been a list of species native to the region. So that's as best baseline that we can get. Our best guesses is that there's about 170, mostly plants and invertebrates that are considered invasive or introduced. Among those are many fishes. And those introductions, again, are intentional as well as accidental. Here's a list of some of those species that are actually introduced species that you don't think of as introduced species, or some of them. Smallmouth bass, for instance. It had been stocked into West Virginia and into Virginia by the mid-1800s. Late 1800s, largemouth bass and channel catfish, some of these species that we think of as resident species are actually introduced, naturalized species, certainly. Bluegill, up to more recent introductions. So the blue catfish and most recently the snakehead in 2004. But there's these introductions, some intentional, some not intentional, but important to keep track of. And anglers are out there collecting more data than any fisheries biologist could possibly collect because they're covering such a large amount of area, places that aren't sampled scientifically, but are picking up fish such as the snakehead and other introduced species that might need to be monitored. Then there's another category that in this changing environments that we're finding ourselves in, there are what I'm referring to as natural introductions. So natural introductions being range extensions of more southerly species. The scup up there in the black and white drawing is a native species to the Chesapeake Bay region. It's a porgy. To the south, there's the long-spined porgy. And these two photos show the difference there in this extension of the first dorsal fin ray. This was caught in ocean off the Ocean View Pier in Norfolk in 2007. So there's the potential of these more southerly species entering into the bay. And these photos were sent to me by a recreational angler asking for identification. And so this is the sort of application that we can see the RecFish app being a useful, not just for the identification for the angler, but also for us to recognize new or unusual occurrences of species within the bay. Of the 270 or to 300 species of fishes in the bay, there's about 85 families. Some of these, you know, are a single species within the family is present in the bay. There's just here is a list of seven families that are quote unquote important, because I think all fishes are important, but you know, these are sort of classic or ecologically important groups of fishes that we think of in the bay. The shads and herrings, certainly the Chesapeake Bay has been a historically an important fishing ground for shad and herring. The populations are unfortunately low at this point. Anchovies, there's only two species of anchovy in the bay, but they are probably the most important fish in the bay as forage food for pretty much everything else that lives in the bay, from crabs to fish. So if you're looking for the most important fish in the bay, it's probably an anchovy. Killifish and some of these other ones you don't think of, you don't see gobies, but there's a lot of them out there. And believe it or not, they are caught on hook and line in those types of habitats Lisa was talking about that aren't very easily sampled through nets and through typical fisheries sampling. Some of the more iconic, if you will, are the temperate basses, the white perch and the striped bass, sort of icons of the Chesapeake Bay. The drums, which are, there's a group of about 17 species in the bay that that includes the croaker, spot, red drum, weak fish, black drum. The Chesapeake Bay is a really remarkable spot for drum diversity. And some of these are certainly iconic. The red drum supports a very large recreational fishery, but there are others, members of this family, that are a lot more secretive, that are a lot less sampled. And then finally, the flounders. The flounders in the family Paralichthyidae. These are very notably the summer flounder that is a wonderful both commercial and recreational fish. But again, this is another example of one of these natural introductions. There are reports of another species, the southern flounder, there at the bottom left, which is a more southerly species, as the name would imply, typically found south of Cape Hatteras. But the adults every once in a while, late summer, would show up in the bay. But we've been picking up juvenile southern flounder in the rivers. And there's no way that we can canvass as much river miles as we would like. But if we get people using this type of app, we can get photographs, and there's differences between the two species that will be apparent on a photograph. We might be able to better track that natural invasion of species such as the southern flounder. The Chesapeake Bay is also an ideal spot for development of this type of app, because we also have the basis in the Nunnally Ichthyology Collection at VIMS, which is the largest preserved fish collection of Virginian fishes anywhere. Over 500,000 individual preserved fish document the past distribution of fishes, as well as provides the basis for comparing those distributions that come in off of RecFish or other sampling methods. It will contribute to the general and the basic knowledge of where fishes are, when, and what species are living in our Chesapeake Bay. I can turn it back to Lisa.
Thank you, Eric. So here's how you can help. So as I mentioned earlier, we're going to go live with a public version of the website in the next week or so. And we would love it if you would help us test and improve the website. It is a work in progress, and we would love to have your feedback. The website is recfish.org, and you can give us your comments just by going to the contact button at the top of the page that's circled in red here on the slide, and that will pop up a form where you just put in your email, your name, and your comments. And we'll get back to you if you need a response or if you just want to make suggestions, that's great. The other thing that we are in desperate need of are fish photos. As I said before, it takes about 5,000 photos per species. And what we really need are photos of, we'll take photos of all of your fish, but what we really need is photos of the fish that you're not so proud of catching, because those are the ones that we have a really hard time getting photos of. So something like striped bass, we can find a lot of photos of striped bass to use, but other things are a lot more difficult to find if we're just trying to use a web search or something like that. So we appreciate your photos of any kind of fish, toadfish, you name it, would be great. If you have the photos at high resolution, we would rather have them at high resolution. One meg is what the modelers like as a minimum, but we'll take any photos you have. And just to give you an idea of what that's going to look like on the website, you can either share photos of a bunch of mixed species of fish if you don't know your species or if you don't have time to sort through them and divvy them up into folders by, you know, what the species is. Or if you do want to help and actually divide them up by species and upload them that way, you can. We have all the Chesapeake Bay species on the website. And if you know the name, you can just go to the search bar at the top and start typing the name. And it'll narrow down your search and it'll narrow down this list of icons. And it can be either the preferred common name that's shown under the thumbnail here, or it can be another common name. So like if you type in bunker, you will get menhaden. And when you actually click on the name of menhaden, it'll pop up a bigger window to show you some more information, alternate names, and actually give you a bigger image of the fish to confirm that that's really the species you were looking for. And when it comes to sharing the photos, you can either drag and drop them, or if you happen to have your photos in albums somewhere like either Google Photos or Amazon Prime Photos, I know both have this, you can just share the URL for the photo album instead of actually having to upload them. And some of those websites also, if you're like me and you have a couple hundred fish photos mixed in with 10,000 other photos, I know for a fact Google Photo and Amazon Photos, you can just type in the word fish and it will narrow down your photos to any photo it thinks has a fish in it, and it'll, about half of them will have fish and half of them will have other things that look fish-like, but it really helps narrow it down and make the search faster if you have a bunch of photos. And then finally, the other way that that you can help is tell us what you would like to see in a recreational fishing app. What would be useful to you? The basic data that we're going to record are date, time, location, species, length. The basic info we're planning to provide is whether your catch is legal or not, so that you don't have to look up the regulations. But we're really interested in learning what else you think would be useful to have in a fishing app. Do you need to know whether the fish is edible or not? Do you want to know about like health hazards? Like, is there a chance that it has a high mercury level? Do you want more information about the fish? Like, what's its diet and habitat and range? Do you want to know the maximum size? You know, what's the state record for that species? Would you like something like my Amazon Photos pops up on this day in 2015, you were doing this and shows me a photo. Would you like to have that for fish to show you what you were catching in the past on that day? Or would you be interested in your own catch per unit effort where you log your trip and you can actually say, okay, I caught 6 striped bass on that trip. That was 1 fish per hour. But when I fished this other location, I only caught 3 and it was a half per hour, something like that. Do you want to share your photos with the public? Do you want this to be a photo sharing app where you can brag about what fish you caught? Or do you want to be able to compete with friends? Would you like to set up sort of a ad hoc fishing tournament with you and your buddies where you can compare who caught what and you have to prove it by showing their photo with the fish with the length on it? So sort of the sky's the limit. We'd love to hear all of your suggestions and you know, any ideas you have, we would be very grateful to hear. And again, you can send us those comments just by going to the contact us section of the webpage on recfish.org. And that function is up and running now, so you can go ahead and do that anytime you want. The upload photos, we're making some changes to over the next few days. So you might want to hold off a few days before trying to upload photos, but you're welcome to go ahead and try it out if you want. And with that, we would just like to say thank you to the VIMS and Directors Innovation Fund that first encouraged us to think outside the box and come up with this concept in the first place, Morgan Massey, who provided the initial funding for that, the Innovation Fund work group, who works so hard each year to make those selections. As I said, Rob Cortell, who's a member of that work group, has been instrumental in moving this project forward. Also, the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation has provided funding, and a wide range of management agencies and NGOs have both expressed support for the project and have also provided guidance and advice. And most especially, we'd like to thank recreational anglers, because this project won't happen without you. So with that, I'd like to say thank you and be happy to take any questions you might have, and Eric would as well, I'm sure.
All right, thank you so much, Lisa and Eric. So we do have a few questions coming in already, so we'll just jump into it. So a lot of people are asking what the development timeline is and when it will be available for public usage.
So we literally just got the funding for app development in December. We are getting the contract in place right now. So we're looking at probably a year timeline before we truly have something that you can take on your phone and it's fully functional for at least the most common species. But in the meantime, we're also on the website likely going to have an option to upload your photos and have the machine learning model try to ID them. So you can sort of check on our progress, and it'll try to ID your fish. And if the model's wrong, you can tell the model it's wrong. So that's one of the features that we're planning on working on the website as sort of a fun way to interact with the app sort of during the development phase.
All right, so is an app like this being done anywhere else? And do you see it going further to other states and agencies for adoption there?
We haven't seen an app that's exactly like this. So that's part of the research that we've done. There is an app that's out there that we're actually looking at collaborating with called Fish Rules, which provides the regulation information. And they have, you know, photos that help you ID your fish. But one of the things that we think is really unique about our approach is the machine learning models that are going to provide automated fish identification. And part of the reason I'm excited about that, like most people know what a striped bass is, but if you can point your phone at it and not have to surf up striped bass to capture that data, if you can just point your phone at it, it says it's a striped bass, you log it as a striped bass, it literally takes you one click of an icon to collect that data. I think that's really the unique thing that we're looking at. There are other apps that are targeting particular research projects, but a lot of those, to be honest, you have to answer a dozen questions. And as I get older, I less appreciate apps with 6-point font that are so small that I can't really read them if I'm out on a boat. So we're really trying to go icon-based and make it super simple, super straightforward, and you can literally collect data by pointing your phone at the fish and pressing a button.
That's amazing.
And we do intend to expand. So we're using Chesapeake Bay as the starting point. And as Eric noted, we have overlap of species from the north and from further south. And so that really gives us a leap on expanding up and down the coast, because we'll actually have a substantial number of those species modeled already. So we hope to expand pretty rapidly once we have it down.
Cool. So as far as the data goes, will it only be used by VIMS scientists, or do you anticipate something like eBird where you're able to share with other scientists in the public?
Oh, we plan to make it all publicly available, stripped of any, won't have any personal information. We're not collecting any information on you other than your email address. There will be absolutely no way to, catch an illegal fish and get fined for it or anything like that. The goal is to really use the eBird model on that front and have a database that's publicly available. I mean, eBird database is so extensive and so widely used that they're actually writing their own statistics programs to analyze those data. Like, that's how frequently they're getting used. It's kind of an amazing thing they've done.
Awesome. So this data, someone missed when you were talking about it being geo-referenced. So could you discuss that a little bit?
Yeah, so that's one of the things that we thought a fair amount about and that we're going to let the user have control over. So you will be able to either share your exact location, which obviously has the greatest value to scientists if we know the exact point on the map you were, but there's a huge amount of information even in just knowing which tributary you were in or which section of the tributary. So one of the other options we're looking at for other reasons, the bay is already divided up into segments and we're thinking about offering up that segmentation system because it already is used in a lot of different ways, particularly with water quality. So we're looking at that. And then if you don't, and usually we'll break up a river into like three sections, you know, upper, lower, and mid section, which isn't really going to give away your favorite fishing spot. But if you're not comfortable with that, we'll, you know, you can submit your data with no geo-reference whatsoever. It's just not as useful to us.
Now, we also had a question about maybe there could be, or a recommendation, maybe they could have an option to share the location for research, but not with the public for keeping their spots private. Do you think that would be logistically possible if the data is open source like that?
Yeah, I think we can. And even for the photos, when you upload those, you'll see on the page, you can upload your photos and submit them for RecFish use only so that they go into a folder. We use them only for RecFish, don't ever get shared with anybody else. Or you can designate them research only, meaning that we share them with other people doing research, but they have to share a data, they have to sign a data sharing agreement. They will never make them public because you've said they're only for recreational use, for research use. And then you have the option to just freely upload your photos and basically make them freely available to the public. So we're doing everything we can think of, happy to have your suggestions, to make comfortable with sharing at whatever level of openness or privacy they would like to have.
Awesome. We have a lot more questions. There are a couple of questions about getting people other than anglers involved, such as recreational scuba divers and fish tagging programs that are catch and release. Do you see them being able to adopt this, or are you targeting them, making them aware of it?
We're truly launching our outreach to all the groups we can think of next month. Honestly, COVID, we have shifted. We plan to do a lot of the things we were planning to go to, you know, fishing clubs and boat shows and that kind of thing to talk to people. And obviously COVID killed all of that. And so what we did was sort of flip the project around and focus on the machine learning first. And now that I've got to make progress on the public outreach point, and it's pretty much going to have to be one-on-one or by Zoom instead of in person in the way I would have liked. So any ideas you have for other groups that might be in, we love to hear from you. Just let us know through the contact page, because I there's no reason to limit it to recreational anglers.
Thanks. So another idea was having a category for a user to know if there's a potential citation size for the species. And someone asked, what is your process for updating fishing regulations in the app?
So the fishing regulations in the app, we're actually going to work with Fish Rules, which has been adopted by NOAA as their preferred means of providing regulations. They already have an app, and there's a way through an API link their app to our app. And so will they update their data as soon as those regulations come out? They actually have a software program agencies can use to distribute the new regulations as they come out. And it's really widely used in a lot of states, unfortunately not quite as much in Virginia. It's not as widely adopted. The saltwater regs are there, but the freshwater regs aren't. But we're gonna work with them to bring all of that online and link the two up so that those regulations will be up to date by working with fish rules.
Yeah. All right, there are a lot of questions still left. So I guess I'll just end with one rolled in together and then I'll let everyone know where they can send the rest of their questions if they'd like. So a few people are interested in getting the message out to other recreational anglers, and some are interested in taking it to their high school students. So is there any way other than this presentation, maybe something more simple that they'd be able to share? Like, do you have a Facebook page or something? Or what can they
use to spread the word? We haven't gone there yet, in part because we've really been waiting for the final website to be, I was really hoping tonight would be the website, but we're only about a week away, I think. And so that's when we're really going to make a big, larger media push to try to get this out to people and have them start contributing photos. I guess I'm not entirely sure on the high school front exactly what might be needed. So if you could send me an email through the contact us page on the website, I can work with you on that.
And I will respond to him now. Let's see. And then again, that address is recfish.org, and all of the addresses that we've talked about tonight are currently in the chat. All right. All right, and I guess one last one. There was a question about, do you think it's just going to be fish, or do you think it's going to expand to capture marine invertebrates as well?
I would love for it to capture marine invertebrates. And so would Jenny Dyer, my lab manager. We both have this like ulterior motive, both are people, not fish people so much. it would be awesome if we do that, but machine learning model part with the automated ID, really, it takes a lot of photos, and depending on the invert, they can look really different because they don't have, think about all the different shapes an oyster can be, they can have all kinds of different morphologies. And be honest, I'm not sure how you would train a machine learning model to be absolutely confident that that was an oyster. So I think there's some challenges there. There's some species that it would be much easier to work with. But I would love to see that down the road. I would also love to see it, meshed with other data that people are interested in. VIMS creates amazing data sets, whether it's, are the bottom waters anoxic, or, those sorts of things I think would be really interesting to integrate down the road. But to be honest, we have our hands full with fish right now. Yeah.
You've got to start somewhere.
We're starting somewhere.
Awesome.
All right. And I'm slowly learning my fish species.
There you go. Yeah, it's a teaching tool.
Next phase, you can teach me invertebrates. So
I'll put Jenny in charge of that.
If you liked what you heard tonight and would like to contribute to the VIMS Innovation Fund to continue great science like the science Lisa and Eric are doing, or any other area of VIMS, you can make a gift at vims.edu/giving. If you'd like to talk to someone at VIMS about giving opportunities, please email programs@vims.edu. And if you have any questions that were not answered tonight that you really want to get to them, you can contact them via the recfish.org contact us, or you can send those over to programs@vims.edu as well, and we can get that to Lisa and Eric. Thank you both so much. And thanks everyone for joining us, and have a great evening.
Thank you all for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.